but we're on my Instagram. This is Dr. Watkins is actually hosting it. So right. This is going to be his show. But we're on my Instagram. So those of you who don't, hopefully if you're following me on Instagram, you know who I am, but you might not know who Dr. Robert Watkins the IV is. Dr. Robert Watkins the IV is one of the most renowned spinal surgeons in our country. He has trained any and every amazing spinal surgeon. I think him and his dad, Dr. Robert Watkins the III, who I've also had the pleasure of working with, have trained so many spinal surgeons. They were our physicians with the LA Dodgers, which is how Doc and I know each other. We go way back at least 10, 12 years at this point, which is kind of crazy.
Right.
So that's who he is. He's amazing.
Yeah, I appreciate that. And also in our practice, we're in Los Angeles. My dad and I still work together half for 18 years, and we still take care of the Dodgers and Rams and Lakers and Clippers and USC athletic department. We treat every sport, the LAFC, the soccer too, and in spines. We just do backs and necks. And we developed this app called Back Doctor, and that's how I got into the technology about 2 to 3 years ago. We give it away for free. It's got our whole quantitative structured program in it. And then I started doing Facebook Lives and interviewed like Gary Vee and different doctors doing stem cell injections and stuff. And so we put on a conference once a year for physical therapists and athletic trainers here in Los Angeles. You usually get around 250 people there, where we talk about spine issues specifically related to athletes and sports and how to return to sports. And you're one of our favorite speakers of all time. Everybody always loves you. And so I really appreciate you always coming out and joining us. And we couldn't do it this year, obviously, because of the COVID madness. And so, you know, it's been really fun for me to branch into this new technology, do live interviews. I mean, who knows, you know, where things are going to go as far as, you know, doing. And I know you're traveling all over the world nonstop, giving talks and big lecture halls and everything else. And it's such a great interaction when you're there with people and you feel the audience and you get to answer questions live. But this is great. You know, the fact that everybody's at home and we click a button and share information. I'm so excited because you're a wealth of knowledge. And I've got so many people who, you know, it's not just about surgery. Everybody wants to try and avoid surgery. It's about everything else. It's about back pain in general, what you can do to avoid it. What can you do if you get it? Most people don't need surgery. You know, how do you evaluate these other techniques and technologies like dry needling and manipulation and laser and cold therapy? Nobody wants to have surgery, and surgery kind of gets a bad rap, and people say we spend too much money on surgery, on back surgery, they want to cut it. But what about the other alternative treatments like back braces sold on late night TV? There's $1 billion spent on alternative treatments that don't nearly undergo the same scrutiny that spine surgery does. And so, you know, getting understanding, one of the things that's fascinating to me, your role as an athletic trainer when you're with the Dodgers and even as physical therapist, everything else, is how do you evaluate products? How do you evaluate new techniques, especially when you've got high profile athletes with big names and long reputations and they've done it their way. They come in and say, oh, I got this guy, I got this girl who does this technique and we got to do this. How do you evaluate that and say, okay, well, here's what's reasonable, here's what's safe, and how do we do it? And so I'm excited to have you on because I want to hear about your process for going through these things. And we'll talk about back pain and some of the dry needling, cupping, manual therapy, these different techniques. I'm really excited to have you on for that. So thank you for being here and thank you for having me on your show.
Yeah. No, I love it. It's so true, right? And I think that's why I got along so well with you and your dad is that, you know, it's very rare to hear a surgeon say that they don't always want to go to surgery, right? Like that's what you do. Like I'm a physical therapist. Like my go-to is to do physical therapy. You're a surgeon. You want to do surgery. That's what you do.
Yeah.
But you and your dad have such an amazing appreciation and love for rehab. Like I will never forget when I was doing rehabilitation with one of the guys, and it was a pretty long, intense rehab. You would remember it.
Right.
And you guys both came down to the athletic training room and sat there and watched my entire rehab program, not out of scrutiny, but on a like, oh my gosh, what are you doing? I want to understand your rehab process. And I've just never had, I mean, those of you who are joining in, right? Like how many orthopedic surgeons for any area of the body have ever like showed up to your clinic and like sat and watched your rehab because they wanted to learn more about rehab. So like right out of the gate, I'm like, I like these two guys. They're really cool. They're super fun.
Yeah.
So we've always been able to have great discussions.
Totally. And that's one of the great things about you know, especially treating athletes, 95% of the athletes we treat, we don't operate on, but we're in the locker room and helping to make decisions. People ask us, well, when can they throw 60 feet? When can he hit a ball? When can he do, when can they start to row? And all, and if as a surgeon, the only way you're going to know those answers is get in the locker room and watch and find out what they have to do to their sport. Because we just assume we, when we have our spine conferences, everybody talks about return to play. And for us, it's like, okay, they're cleared to play. Well, there's a lot that happens between cleared to play and on the field. And you don't learn that unless you get down in the locker room and watch people, what they're doing. And it's fascinating because there's a lot of steps, and trying to quantitate it and come up with some guidelines that everybody can be on the same page is really difficult because every patient's different and everything else. But I appreciate how much you taught me and my father and how much we learned in that process, because it was great. I really enjoyed working with you hands-on.
Yeah, it was super fun. And like you said, that objectivity to get back to the field, right? And you guys really created like your five-step program where, right, we have our level ones, our level twos, our level threes, and as they progress through the rehab process. And I remember us having discussions about like other things that can be included in those levels. And so yeah, kind of expanding that to, okay, well, at a level three, they should also be able to maybe be doing, you know, this, they should be maybe starting to throw, or they should be able to do this. And level four, if they're really a true level four, they've got enough stability and decreased pain that they can start jogging and start, right? So we started to kind of attach other things to it. But again, I think that's where your expertise and your perspective and the thing that makes you really, really special is that as a surgeon, you understand that and understand that we have to put objectivity to the return to play process, because we can't just say like, oh, okay, well, they don't have any pain anymore, they can start to run. It's like, well, that doesn't necessarily, right, the minute they start to run, their pain is going to come back. So what other objective things can we look at in order to say, hey, yeah, we think in an educated way that they're able to return to the field.
Yeah, totally. And so, and one of the lectures that you gave probably 5-10 years ago that I loved was the system that you had for training athletes and rehabilitating people back, and a comprehensive approach. And so tell my listeners, if we ever get this over to Facebook, a bit about what you're doing now. Your structure and function company, your webpage just launched yesterday, right?
And yeah, our online stuff.
So what are you doing now?
Yeah, so a few different things. One, our education company, Structure and Function Education. Most people know us up to this point as a dry needling education company, which we are still heavy into the dry needling education, and that's something I'm super passionate about and part of my personal learning process. But now, with everything that's been happening, we've actually been having in the works an online education program for the last 6 months. Obviously, we accelerated that over the last kind of 4 to 6 weeks, and we just launched that yesterday. And so on there, we're super excited to now be able to offer classes surrounding my book that came out last year, Bridging the Gap from Rehab to Performance. That's exactly this topic that we've been talking about. We've got classes that are surrounding that topic. So now we can expand to strength coaches and personal trainers and fitness professionals. So really excited to kind of be able to bring education to that group as well, because the return to play process is super difficult, right? And there's lots of different boxes that you sort of have to check. And they don't necessarily have to be checked in order, but they need to be checked, right? Like, we have to work on identifying the pain generator and seeing how that fits within their motion segment, right? So meaning we have to be able to identify both cause and source of someone's pain, right? It's not enough to just deal with one of those. And then, is the right muscle firing at the right time, right? So that's what I call psychomotor control. And then everything related to the nervous system. So I just finished a webinar on the nervous system type stuff, which is, you know, balance, proprioception, how do we manipulate vision, the vestibular system, all of those sorts of things. And then we move into the strength and power phases, right? So people have to be able to pick up heavy stuff, and they have to be able to do it with speed. Yep. And then we move into foundational athletic movements. Can people apply that strength and speed and power to acceleration, multidirectional work, linear work, all of those sorts of things? And then that final box is, okay, are they a baseball player? Are they a football player? Are they a soccer player? Are they a tennis player? And so making sure that along the continuum, we're actually hitting every part of that organizational system. They don't have to pass one level, because certainly people can work on strength and balance at the same time, or people can work on strength in certain areas, even if they're in pain. So you don't have to pass one box to get to the next, but every box is important in that return to play process. So you have to make sure that you're addressing everything.
Yeah, how different. It's so complex. I mean, our program is five levels, and the biggest critique that we get from physical therapists and athletic trainers is, well, it's too simple and it's too categorized, and it's a lot of it is land-based and on the ground, and you know, these people are dynamic and up and moving. I guess my question really is, so many factors going into one person's rehab. Does it take an expert at such a high level to be able to evaluate all that and really assimilate it all and come up with a plan for each individual person versus how much of it is it? Can you just say, okay, 80% of people just do these five exercises and you'll be fine. Can you answer that?
That's a really good question. Right. And so when we in my, that organizational system, I talk about things being super, diagnosis specific, meaning when people are in the acute phases of rehab, it does matter, in my opinion, if someone has a disc herniation or a spondylolisthesis or a stenosis, right? Like I treat those people very different in the acute stages of rehab. As we move towards the performance end, kind of in that middle stage, it's something I call more diagnosis inclusive, meaning everybody gets core stability, whatever that means to you, right? Like all of those diagnoses still get some type of a core stability program because now we're in that diagnosis inclusive phase. Then when we get down to the client specific phase of rehab, okay, now it matters. Are they a basketball player or a baseball player? And so, you know, I think that's where we were able to have some really great discussions about that five-step rehab program is because we both understood that there is a time and a place for it. Of course they need to be able to get up against gravity and run and do all of those things. But like we're in the diagnosis inclusive thing. And quite frankly, if they can't, you know, do a plank or some type of a whatever, they're probably not ready to do a plank in a total body lean position, which is a fundamental position for them to do acceleration, right? So how are they gonna run if they can't even hold themselves in a total body lean?
Right.
And they can't hold themselves in a total body lean if they can't do a plank. So we have to be able to extrapolate and sort of continue to go down. But yeah, it's hard. That's why when people like want to be everything to every athlete, I want nothing to do with that. I love having a team of 10 because there's a lot of steps to think about and it's near impossible to always take in every single consideration, right? You always end up kind of forgetting something or skipping over something. So the bigger my rehab team is for the athlete, the better, because we have so many checks and balances like, oh gosh, we didn't do that. Or we need to do this. We got to focus on that. Or, you know, we need to periodize a little bit differently. Right. And that's really where the strength and conditioning coaches come into play. Like they're so great at periodization and helping me. I can't always work on neuromuscular reeducation. There is a time for hypertrophy. There is a time for power development. And who better to help me periodize that than a strength coach?
Right. And we spent a lot of time with the Dodgers when you were the head athletic trainer of the Dodgers. I didn't mention that earlier to my audience. of course, I think everybody knows you by now.
I don't know about that, but thanks.
what do you think about the extrapolation to other sports? The similar type of question, how much overlap is there in all athletes and all sports versus how much specialization is there? Is it kind of 50-50 or is it more one towards the other?
Yeah, that's a great question. So since I've left the Dodgers, which has been like 6 years now, I've worked in international soccer. I've worked in the NFL as a consultant. I've worked in the NBA. You know, so really the only league I haven't seen in season is the National Hockey League. Yeah. And so being exposed to all those other leagues in the last 5 years, they're all different. They're all different sports, obviously, but man, so much of it is the same. And in that organizational system that I talked about before, the only box that changes is that very end box, right? Like, and other than hockey, every sport that I mentioned has to accelerate. They have some of them, some position players, depending on who it is, need absolute speed. Everybody needs to slow down. There's usually some element of jumping and landing. There's some element of multidirectional movement, right? Whether it's crossover, side, you know, shuffle, an open step, a drop step, right? Like we can break down multidirectional movement into its components. So most athletes, I mean, unless you're a swimmer, you're a golfer, but even golfers need change of direction theoretically. There's a few sports that don't need those fundamental movements, but most sports need everything that I just talked about. So really everything up until that box is the same. It's that last box when I apply those concepts to basketball, or I apply those concepts to a quarterback or to an offensive lineman, that they really start to change. So really 90% of it, right? My buddy, Michael Boyle, who's a really well-known strength coach. Most of you guys probably know who that name is if you're into the strength and conditioning world. He talks about this all the time, that like the concept of sport specific training is crap, right? Like he'll be like, we don't do sport specific training. We train 90% of our people exactly the same, because he's right. Most people kind of need the same stuff. And it's that last 10% that we really begin to apply it to, you know, our patient who is a FedEx worker versus our patient who's a major league baseball player, right? So a lot, I think there's more similarities than there are differences when it comes to foundational athletic movement.
Let's get into some of the specifics. So tell me a bit about dry needling. As a, I've seen some of it in the locker room, but tell me the basic as a, you know, as a physician, what is dry needling? And is it different than cupping? Or is it the exact, is it the same thing?
No, definitely different. Right. You know, different than, you know, they, people equate it to acupuncture, right? Like they look at it and they're like, okay, so this is acupuncture. And it really depends on your definition. And I hate like the whole debate of dry needling versus acupuncture just really breaks my heart because I have such a love and respect for Eastern medicine and for my acupuncture friends and community. Like we don't do the same thing. We use the same tool, but we don't use the same, we don't use that tool in the same way, right? Like just like an Eastern medicine practitioner may use a cup in a very different way than a Western medical practitioner would, right? Just like an osteopathic physician is going to be different than an allopathic trained physician, right? So there's similarities, but like how you apply these things are really based around your philosophy, how you have been trained, how you apply these tools. So yeah, while we use the same tool as an acupuncturist per se, we use it in a very, very different way. And I use it in a very neuromusculoskeletal fashion. Any of my patients that have internal dysfunctions, I refer to an acupuncturist, right? Like I work really closely with an acupuncturist. When I was with the Dodgers, we had an acupuncturist on staff, which was wonderful. Ichiro and I shared patients all the time and were able to have those discussions. And so, yeah, like to me, acupuncture goes way beyond dry needling. Like I understand anatomy, I understand physiology, I understand pathophysiology, neurology, right? And so all of those things, I understand safety, I understand how to deal with adverse events. And so all of those things make me prepared and able to utilize a fine filiform needle within my practice. Now, you know, but yeah, you know, and it's a totally different, there's of course plenty of acupuncturists who practice in a Western medical fashion, just like, you know, I'm a Western medicine trained person who is absolutely obsessed and love Eastern medicine stuff. So I spend a lot of time studying that. But I, again, there's more similarities than there's differences. But in my opinion, like dry needling is this one little piece of acupuncture. It'd be like saying you're a physician, right? Well, there's 50 different types of physicians you could be. And to me, that's like same thing. Like dry needling is this one little piece of acupuncture, which is huge.
Right. So there was, and there was a study in JAMA, you know, maybe five, 8 years ago that compared no treatment to random needles to acupuncture. And they basically found that the random needles and the acupuncture both did better than no treatment, but they couldn't find a difference between the two, which is kind of what you're saying. And my takeaway from that was that the needles may stimulate the skin, which may kind of confuse the nerve endings of where the pain is and just throw things off a bit to, and then decrease some pain for that reason. Is that a reasonable explanation of how dry needle and acupuncture may work from a very basic tactile standpoint?
Absolutely. That's a really, really great thing, right? And I think that's where we're trying to figure out, well, let me back up. It's difficult to interpret the needling research because sham acupuncture is not really well defined, right? Or sham needling is not well defined. Like anytime they can say, sometimes it's defined as not needling an actual acupoint. meaning, like you said, you put it in actual acupuncture points or you put the needle in a non-acupuncture point. Some studies call that sham.
Right.
Other people say, okay, no, our sham acupuncture is when you tap the needle, but you don't actually penetrate into, but you still break the epidural layer. Mm-hmm. And so that is, you're right, like one way needles work is that we're changing sensory input. And again, I just talked about this on my last webinar. Sensory input dictates motor output every time. And if we can alter someone's sensory input, we will most definitely change somebody's motor output, right? And I use the example of virtual reality. So I was at this event where they had this virtual reality thing, and they had, it was a plank, like literally a 2x4 plank. And they're like, okay, you just have to stand on the plank and like walk down the plank, and then you have to jump off the end of it. It was like 2 inches off the ground. I'm like, okay, great. So I just did it without the virtual reality glasses on, right? Mm-hmm. So then you put the glasses on and you're in an elevator and you just watch the numbers go up to 60. And then the elevator opens, right, and you see that it's a plank and you see like the entire cityscape, like New York City. And you have to walk to the end of the plank and jump off, right? Yeah. I could not bring myself to do it. I mean, I probably was had those glasses on for 10 minutes right, and did not jump off the end of the plank. Even though I knew darn well I was in a conference room, 2 inches off the ground, my sensory input dictated my motor output every time. And so that's 100% what needles do, is we alter the sensory input. If we change the input, we can change the output.
Cool. That's a great explanation. Yeah. It also makes me just think about kind of the mind-body connection, how we assume they're different, but they're interconnected. And also that, you know, mass, our body is energy, that mass equals M equals MC squared and mass equals energy. And therefore pain is so fascinating because we can't measure it, but maybe it is clearly some type of electrical impulse that's going on in our body. And if somehow you can just change that, subtly change it. And so you're basically saying if you stimulate the sensory nerve endings, you may be able to change that pain firing, but then also dictate how the muscles will respond better.
Yeah, absolutely, right? So there's different things too, especially from a pain standpoint. Locally, a lot of different things, like they've done histology studies where after you insert a needle, like locally what's in the area. So we see that there's CGRP, histamine, substance P, right? Like all these different things that show that we're stimulating a local healing response. Segmentally, we know that we're stimulating a healing response there at each segment, right? So we can utilize concepts of myotomes and dermatomes and visceratomes to sort of affect different things. And then systemically, same thing. We see crazy amounts of endogenous opioid release, monoamine release, right? So serotonin and noradrenaline, norepinephrine. Sorry, Richard is making a little nice appearance because he wants to get down. He's nursing a back injury, speaking of. I know. So we're not letting him jump. I know. I'm actually going to take him to the vet so she can do some little doggy acupuncture on him.
Hey, let me ask you a quick question about what you're saying about that. Does the dry needling, is it most effective for pain, or is it most effective for muscle function and muscle retraining?
Yeah, that's a really great question. So most of the research is done on pain, mm-hmm, because we can measure a lot of these different things from blood draws and histology and all of those sorts of things. And so they're doing some really interesting stuff too with some of the endogenous opioid stuff, research about, you know, getting people off of opioid addictions and those sorts of things, more from an acupuncture standpoint than really a dry needling standpoint. But we know that there's these things that happen, right? And the needle is just the stimulus. There's nothing on the needle, right? The needles aren't magical as much as I would like to think that they are. They're not. They're just a piece of metal. Yeah. But they stimulate a self-healing response in the body. And so that's the beauty of it. And so we also see biomechanical changes. So when you put the needle in and you rotate the needle, we see there's some evidence to show that up to 4 centimeters away from the needle, you actually get collagen deformation, which means you get movement. So for me, from a scar perspective, when I put a needle into somebody's scar and I rotate that needle and know that I'm going to get some tissue deformation 4 centimeters away from where the needle is, like that's huge from a biomechanical perspective and how we utilize principles of mechanotransduction in order to allow the body to help heal that scar and to help heal. That's why the needle is such a powerful tool. There's things happening hormonally, right, and chemically and biomechanically that really make it a very, very interesting tool.
Let me ask you another question in those regards, because it kind of reminds me of the stem cell question of, or PRP, biologic injections, in that when you stimulate a response in the host, do you know, is it good or bad? Is it regenerate? Is it regenerative or inflammatory? And in some ways, we kind of assume inflammation is bad. And if there's inflammatory markers, they're bad. But at the same time, we know the body heals with inflammation. And so distinguishing, okay, you've got a reaction in the body, but do we know, is it good? Is it actually helpful for regeneration? Can you speak to how you may be able to measure that?
Yeah, that's very interesting. And, you know, a lot of times there is sort of that debate, right? Like, is the PRP or the stem cell or whatever, like how much is that really helping versus just creating the lesion, right? Because the lesion alone creates stuff. Like, and I do think there are obviously stem cells and PRP, like there is something to that medication. So I'm not trying to act like there's not, but we know that the needle itself creates a healing response and creates that inflammatory response. And so from an inflammatory perspective, what we like to say from a needling standpoint is that we're not being anti-inflammatory, because you're right. We absolutely need inflammation from a healing perspective in order for the body to move through the stages of healing and heal the issue. So when we put needles in, we feel like we are helping the body move to resolution faster. Mm-hmm. Meaning if we're like in an inflammatory state of something, and I put needles into people, we stimulate that, macrophages and all of those different things into the area, right? And then once those macrophages leave, we know we move into the next stage of tissue healing. And so if we can insert a needle into the body, we actually can stimulate acetylcholine. Acetylcholine production is going to deactivate macrophages. If we deactivate macrophages, then we move to the next stage of healing, right? And so we're not trying to be anti-inflammatory. What the physiological research on needling is showing us is that we're moving to resolution of inflammation faster. Mm-hmm. And as we know in sport, right, if someone has a inflammatory process of 2 days versus 5 days, that makes a big difference in our world.
Yeah.
So if we can help people move through that inflammatory process faster, that's a good thing. If I stop that process, that's probably not a good thing. So yeah, that's cool. Our theory. I'm such a dork. When I hear myself talk, I'm like, oh, that's
great.
A dork.
I know exactly. Macrophage. Good dinner discussion.
I know, right? This should be wine.
Right, yeah. What was I going to ask you? Is dry needling allowed in every state?
It's not. That's a great question. So depending on your credentials after your name,
yeah,
and the state that you practice in, it's totally dependent. So that does make it difficult to find a practitioner.
Yeah.
You know, certain states, physical therapists and chiropractors are not allowed to dry needle. In other states, they are. So there's, I think, about 38 states that are yeses for physical therapists, maybe more, maybe closer to 40. And then about a handful that say no, and then a couple that kind of are in the middle that don't really address it.
Yeah. And then, so how does this relate to like myofascial release or manipulations? You use them in concert with each other. Do you do dry needling first to get rid of some of the inflammation and then move on to the manipulations, or how do they interact with each other?
Yeah, for me, I like to needle first and then do all my manual therapy second, because needles can be very diagnostic for me, meaning if someone comes into me and they're super painful and they've got a loss of range of motion, and I drop 3 or 4 needles into them and they get this like 20 degree change in range of motion, one of two things, right? Like either needles are magic or it's not what I thought it was. And so chances are it's not what I thought it was. And so if I put needles in and they get this huge change in their range of motion or this huge change in their movement, then I know it wasn't a structural issue. It was a functional issue, right? I didn't have a hardware problem. I had a software problem. So I need to now abandon my manual therapy and do tons of neuromuscular re-ed and a ton of therapeutic exercise. If I put 3 or 4 or 5 needles in someone and they really don't get a change in their movement patterns, they don't get a change in their range of motion, then maybe I do have a hardware issue. Maybe I do have a structural problem and I need to do manual therapy. I need to do some joint mobilizations. I need to do instrument assisted or cupping or do some type of soft tissue intervention to try to affect that collagen a little bit more. We know neurological changes can happen pretty quickly. Some more structural changes aren't. So for me, needles can be super diagnostic. So I tend to needle first, do manual therapy second, abandon manual therapy if I need to, and then go right to therapeutic exercise.
Cool. That's great. So tell me about cupping. So how's cupping different than needling as far as the effect on the body? It basically sucks the blood up into the skin, and how's the effect different?
Yeah, so two different types of cupping. Well, lots of different types of cupping, I suppose. But when you read the literature, you have to really look, because sometimes I'll get super fired up about a study and like what it's showing. And then I read the abstract. This is why you always have to read the full study. Right. Cause like, then I'll start to read the full study and they're talking about wet cupping. And I'm like, we don't really do wet cupping in Western medicine. So wet cupping is when they actually lance the skin and they pull blood out, right? Like cool. They pull, kind of a little bit more analogous. Yeah. Like leaching. Exactly. Right. A little bit more analogous to needling, quite frankly, cause we're creating that lesion. Uh-huh. And so that's wet cupping, not really something that typical Western medical practitioners do. Right. Dry cupping is when we don't try to cause bleeding, but we do lift the tissue up, mm-hmm. right? And so we're getting like a distraction underneath the center of the cup. We're still getting a compression around the rim of the cup, but we are getting distraction mostly. And there's lots of different ways to use cups. We can do, I have three different ways to utilize cupping, and we actually have an online cupping course coming out here soon, within the next few weeks, which will be exciting. So we have three different techniques on how we utilize cupping. We use it statically, meaning a static cup on a static body. And that's for different physiological reasons. We can move that cup on a static body for other reasons. And then we can put a cup on somebody and then have them actually move themselves. So we can go static, static dynamic, or dynamic static. That's how we define different types of cupping. So I'll use those different techniques for different reasons. The one reason though, when people really say like they want to argue about cupping or whatever, I really just relate it again to strength and conditioning, like from a periodization standpoint. Everything we do, whether it's instrument assisted, massage, foam roll, massage stick, like every single manual therapy thing that we do is compressive. For the first time, really, we have the ability to be distractive, right? Like we can uncompress the tissue. And I don't know if that's good or bad, but I know it's different. And right. What I do know about the human body is it responds to different stimulus, right? Like there's a reason you don't go to the gym and do the exact same workout every single day. If you did, after 3 or 4 days, you wouldn't feel any, right? You wouldn't be sore. It wouldn't make you tired, right? The body adapts.
Yeah.
So we have to constantly have changing stimulus into the body in order for the body to adapt. If every single manual therapy technique we have is compressive, how are we really allowing the body to adapt? So for me, cupping on an extremely rudimentary, foundational, basic level, cupping is really about being able to, periodize my soft tissue work. And we periodize everything else in strength and conditioning, right? We macrocycle, microcycle, mesocycle, everything. So why wouldn't I want to periodize my soft tissue?
Huh. Meaning will you alternate a compressive technique with a distractive thing the next day, or do all compressive for a couple of weeks, then all distractive?
Yeah. Sometimes I will alter on days, right? So in sports medicine, you know, when you're with a team, I mean, you're with these people, you know, 12 hours a day. And sometimes we can just over-treat out of boredom, right? Like, let's just call a spade a spade. like these guys don't have anything else to do. So they're like, I want to do more treatment. Right. So we just treat. And we never really give the body time to adapt. So what I try to explain to the guys is you wouldn't deadlift every single day in the weight room. So why do you want me to do some type of soft tissue work every single day, right? Like that just physiologically doesn't make any sense, but I try to relate it to them in a way that they can understand.
Yeah.
So then once we kind of get that under control, then maybe you're exactly right. Maybe Mondays we do like an instrument assisted, Tuesdays we cup, Wednesday we schedule a massage, Thursday we do the crazy thing of leave them alone, right? Like we don't do any soft tissue. Friday maybe we do some underwater massage technique, like with a hose, you know, anything like that. Then again, Saturday maybe we're doing some type of instrument assisted. Sunday we're cupping, right? Like we just sort of rotate that stimulus through again so the body can adapt. If we just keep doing the same exact stimulus every day, like, oh my gosh, I can kill my poor athlete with a foam roll,
right?
Like, I mean, you walk into any gym in the US and like people are foam rolling every day.
Right.
And I don't do anything with my athlete every single day.
Yeah.
Why would I want to continue to do massage or some variation of soft tissue every single day? Like it just doesn't make sense.
Yeah, it's an interesting question too, coming back to, so having the variety, like you said, may stimulate the person more, and this, and that kind of brings back into that mind-body connection of pain and limitation of function that you're going to, and we do that, we're guilty of that as doctors too, with medications. You know, you try one medication, somebody calls you too much, they complain, you try a different medication, and then you try a different one, just, and because sometimes it satisfies their need to try something different. So you've got these different techniques. How do you evaluate the techniques? And this somewhat relates to high performance athletes too, in that if you've got a new technique, you've got a new machine, how do you decide you're going to try this on an elite athlete?
Yeah, that's a great question, right? Because they do. I mean, athletes are more informed now than ever, right? So, I mean, 30 years ago, people, Richard is barking. Yeah, I knew we were not going to go for, he's back. We were not going to go for an hour without Richard barking. There was like zero chance there. Yeah. I'm surprised we got as far as we did. But yeah, that's exactly right. Like these guys are super informed and they know what they want. Yeah. And there's no point in arguing with them, right? My first thing, any medical practitioner, is do no harm, right? So I have to make that decision. Is this going to be a safe thing to do with this person in this situation? You know, is it going to harm them? Is there something that is going to be super negative about it? And if there is, then I have that discussion, right? Because I think we forget that too, that evidence-based medicine has patient values as one of their things, right? And so the patient's opinion matters a lot in our treatment choices. So when a patient brings something to me and says, hey, I want to try this technique, if I say, you know what, that's stupid, there's no research behind that, all I've done is make the athlete not trust me. Right. And not bring stuff to me. So that doesn't nobody any good. So if someone brings something to me super out of the wall, I've got to research it out. I've got to decide, is this scientifically sound? Is it physiologically sound? Does it make anatomical sense? Is there something that's going to hurt my patient? You know, and if there is, I need to have that discussion with them as an adult so they understand like why maybe I don't think this is a good idea for them. And if I have a true belief like this is going to harm them, then I need to stick to that. Yeah. Opinion, but I need to try to bring them along with me, right? If it's not going to harm them, but maybe there's not a ton of evidence behind it, well, the evidence does show us that patients' belief systems actually matter, right? So there was actually this really great study that that I reviewed that looked at specifically in back pain, massage versus acupuncture. And what they did was people came in to this, to the thing and they had back pain. And so the researchers asked them, do you think massage or acupuncture is going to help you? And if they said acupuncture and they were placed in the acupuncture group, their patient reported outcome measures, their decreases in pain, they actually were like improved by like 86%. Right. If they said acupuncture and they were put in the massage therapy group, they actually, their results were like 60% positive. It was like a significant 20% difference. And then vice versa. If they came in and said, I think massage is going to help me, they were put in the massage therapy group. Sure enough, they got like 86% positive results. If they were put in the acupuncture group, they got decrease in their results. So what that study tells me is that your patient's belief system matters. If they believe it is going to help them, it's going to help them, right?
I'll tell you an extrapolation in low back pain is if you have a painful disc and you either have a fusion or an artificial disc replacement, the results have basically been shown to be about the same, but the patient satisfaction of who had the artificial disc was higher than the fusion and the return to work was faster. Well, that's due to the fact that the patients were told before they went to, you know, they're either going to get this barbaric old fusion or this new artificial disc replacement. And they woke up and were told, sorry, you got the fusion versus this great new prosthesis. And so it affected the outcome. And so we see that in our job a lot too. Everybody thinks the newest is going to be the greatest. And you've got to be able to sort that out in the data as to, is it a true difference or is it just patient perception?
Absolutely. And your perception too, there's actually an interesting study that talks about the clinician's opinion. And so what they looked at, same thing, you know, a lot of the stuff is done in back pain. And so they looked at, you know, manipulation versus mobilization and which sort of helped people who had back pain more. And sure enough, their patient report outcome measures, all this stuff, everything, their outcomes were pretty similar, mobilization versus manipulation. But then when they divided it out, they just took the same data. It wasn't a different different study. They just looked at the data a different way, right? Which is a fantastic lesson on you can manipulate the data, right? The same data. So what they did though was they manipulated the data to say, okay, what if we asked the therapist, do you think manipulation or mobilization helped or is going to help them?
Yeah.
And they said manipulation. And sure enough, that clinician's patients got better versus if the clinician thought mobilization would work.
Yeah.
So there's even a little bit of evidence to show what your belief as a clinician makes a difference, right? So if you're like, oh, this is the newest, greatest technique, right, this is going to be awesome.
Right.
Then of course you sell it, a little bit differently too. And it affects outcomes.
It was like that great advertisement they had going about the doctor who just got off suspension and came into the patient's room and was like, we'll just figure it out when we get in there. We'll see what works. And so if you believe in it, it does have a huge therapeutic effect. There's no question. Let me ask something about back pain. Anybody, I'm turning 50 soon and all my friends are breaking down too. What? And so I try and give people, okay, look, here's the bottom line. Like, do this exercise, because you go on the internet, you got like an hour program, all this kind of stuff. What are the bare basics of what you think people should do for back pain? Say you've got some low grade chronic back pain. And what can they do on their own? What do you think is the most effective, efficiently?
Yeah, that's a really great question. And I think when we look at some of the literature just on pain in general, right? And especially with back pain stuff, a lot of it is education, right? Like there's that whole biopsychosocial component to back pain because back pain is super debilitating to people, right? It's been linked with depression and lots of different things like that. So the research will tell us a lot of education as well, which I think is super important. But you're right, everybody wants the one exercise or what right. can I do? And so, my biggest thing is just to evaluate their general movement, like legitimately, not even exercise, like how much are you getting up and going for a walk? How much are you getting up away from your desk? How much are you standing during the day, right? Like getting out of these sitting positions. I mean, I have never sat in front of a computer more than I have in the last 6 weeks, right? And so I absolutely have to work out every single day because if not, I would sit at this desk and I know better. I'm a physical therapist, I'm a strength coach, like I know better. And yet here I am still sitting all day long. And Kevin, you'll be happy to know as I play my guitar too. Guitar buddy is on here, right? Yeah, sitting, playing my guitar, right? Like it's all about sitting. So one, it's like my number one thing is how much are you actually moving? I don't care what exercise you're doing. You just need to not be sitting and being static because we know the spine is nourished with movement, right? And so the joints, the discs, all of those things respond really, really nicely to movement. So one, I just want to know, are you moving? Because if you're sitting at your desk all day, then you're probably not going to That's number one. So we got to just get you up and moving. Number two, I love doing a lot of yoga based movements. And I know I've got my yoga teacher training, so I know it's really easy for me to kind of go to the yoga route, but back pain can send people into such a sympathetic state, right? Because it is so debilitating, sitting, standing, walking, laying down, everything hurts. And so I love the combination of sort of some breath-based meditation that's typically associated with different types of yoga to get them moving in a really safe, gentle manner that's super low impact, but super, super spine healthy. Now, of course, you can do crazy types of yoga, right? Like all types of yoga are not created equal. So I will typically tell people to try to find like a nice, easy vinyasa flow yoga where they can associate and do some breath work, but that kind of gets them moving a little bit. So again, I just tell them vinyasa flow type yoga, maybe even a restorative type yoga would be a really nice thing to do. Again, just to get them a little bit of mobility, get them moving and get them breathing. To me, those are like the bare bone basics for people with back pain.
Yeah, cool. I totally agree. The anything in the future that's on the horizon that you're excited about that you think either mind, body, energetic techniques, anything that you're excited about that you think is coming down the pipe or you're interested in looking into?
Yeah, it's my brain right now is in reconciling Eastern and Western medicine. That's just sort of where I'm at, right? And just kind of digging into and just reading as much as I can about different Eastern medicine things and just trying to work on reverse engineering some of those things into Western medicine. And, you know, lots of intelligent people have done that before me. And so just kind of really reconciling those things and then continuing like from a yoga practice, you know, I think that that's super interesting. I'm always kind of looking at that, you know, as far as technology goes, I'm not with the team right now. I do have a concierge practice. I am treating athletes on a weekly basis, not a daily basis, but I still treat weekly. Mm-hmm. You know, but I have a concierge practice, so I'm on the road, meaning if it doesn't go in my backpack, it doesn't come with me.
Yeah.
So from a technology, So from a technology perspective, I'm a little bit out of the loop. Mm-hmm. And then the fascial manipulation stuff I think is really, really interesting too from a manual therapy technique. Again, that's another area of study for me. Antonio Stecco, Carla Stecco, we actually, Structure and Function, we host the fascial manipulation classes as part of our education offerings, which is awesome to be partnered with them. They're really on the cutting edge of the fascial manipulation, how fascia relates to pain, how fascia relates to movement. And so again, that's sort of where my brain is and it's not super sexy, I guess, but super rooted in science and super rooted in anatomy, which again is just sort of where my brain is right now, getting back to the basics.
Yeah. The East West combo. I think I might've mentioned my wife, actually does Reiki energy healing and teaches.
Yeah.
Is a hypnotherapist. And, these days for me, I do cardio for 30 minutes and then I meditate for 30 minutes. And the combo of the two of those is amazing because you can feel any way you want to feel just by the combination of those two. You don't need to go to Hawaii. You don't need to leave your house. You can do all the, you know, since we're stuck, you can all the comfort. And it's really a combination. I really, you know, it's inspired me more and more with my patients to really teach them that, look, you got to take control of your life. Not just from an exercise perspective, but you've got to get in touch with how to relax and decrease the tension in your body. Because if you really relax in a proper state, you can let go of any pain or tension in your body. And it just takes training. And, you know, my dad said, I can't meditate, you know, because he's such a type A go-getter. And I'm like, first of all, that's BS. You know, meditation in many ways is taking 30 minutes out of your day to lay in a comfortable spot. I lay down. You don't need to sit or be in some uncomfortable
place. Right, totally.
Take 30 minutes out of your day for yourself to relax, clear your head, and don't have any agenda. Like at the very least, just do that. And then if you want to meditate, you want to meditate or do whatever, but just that 30 minutes, of alone time to let everything go in your life, I think it's vital. And it's made my life much more gratifying and satisfying. And I've had less pain and issues doing it. So I think it really is cool, especially living in Los Angeles and America that day with podcasts and apps, the way we're able to learn from other people from all over the world, integrating those two together, I think is key. I think I'm going to have a lot less back surgeries to do because most people can treat a lot of that non-operatively, the bottom line.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Right. Yeah, you'll decrease your practice, but your wife's practice will increase.
Exactly.
So, you know,
I'll just treat the nerve. I'll treat the compressed nerves, which is the fun part anyway. So the
there you go. There you go. That's right. Right.
So I think we'll wrap it up. But so I want to make sure. So your web page is structureandfunction.com, correct?
.net.
.net. Structureandfunction.net. And that's where everybody can find out about your courses and all the online stuff. And then once you get up and running again and traveling all over the world, they know where to track you down, whatever zip code you're in.
Exactly. Cool. Yeah, we will be able to come together again. We just don't know exactly when that will be. But yeah, in the meantime, we've got all of our online stuff and we're doing tons of stuff like this, right? Like just trying to connect with people digitally and technologically and which is just a really nice thing as well, right? As we're all at home. So looking forward to when we can come together again.
Totally. And our webpage is watkinsspine.com. And in fact, I just created a whole virtual consultation where the experience of the history and the physical exam and the diagnostic tree, I made it all into videos where people, and that's what I did. I've been meaning to do that for 2 years. And because
awesome.
I was quarantined for a week, so I did it all at home and knocked it out. So I think it'll be a lot of fun just how, like you said,
that's awesome.
We had these plans and now that we're stuck at home, we actually had time to, you know, make ourselves virtual and connect another
that's
way.
Right.
Yeah,
that's right.
Hopefully it expands our horizons.
Yeah. I hope so. Yeah, absolutely. Funny how the gift of time will make you kind of hit that next project. So that's awesome.
Exactly. And spend more time with your dog.
Yeah. he's getting to the point where he's sick of me though. That's the sad part. That's how you know you're home too much, is when the dog would rather be alone a little bit.
Yeah. I think my dog pulled a hamstring the other day. Like, she couldn't even get up because we were walking her so much, you know.
Oh, yeah. I know.
Right. That's cool. Well, it was great having awesome. You. Great having you on, and thanks for having me on. It was a lot of fun.
Yeah, super fun. I'm so glad we got to connect. I'm sorry we're not going to be able to connect in June, but this was a great way to catch up with each other and connect, and great to connect with everybody who joined us. And yeah, wow. Awesome.
If anybody has any questions, obviously put them in the comments, and we'll respond, and then we'll try and put it on Facebook and figure all that out part two. That's phase two.
Yeah, that's phase two of our plan. We'll figure it out.
Exactly. Well, thanks everybody for joining us. So we'll be in touch.
Yeah, my pleasure. Sounds great, Doc. We'll see you soon. Bye, guys. Thanks for joining us.